passed on when I was 2 years old. Didn't leave me a thing but a whole lot of soul. You see, I'm a blues man. Man, man, you know I'm a blues man. Want the whole world to know why I'm a blues man. My mother passed on when I was just about 8. Start learning I was growing up in a world of hate that made me a blues man. You see why I'm a blues man? I want the world to understand what made me into a blues man.
My name is Bart Dziegielewski. I'm an amateur filmmaker and a musician. I live in Carbondale, Illinois, home of Southern Illinois University. At the time of making this film, however, I lived in Raccoon Valley Trailer Park, about 5 minutes south of Carbondale in Macanda. And it was there that I first met Valvino Kendrick, otherwise known as the Little Blues Man, or just Bluesman for short. To me, he was one of the many interesting characters that lived out there, but what sets him apart from other people is that he is a very talented blues singer.
Hey everybody, let's have some fun. You only live once, and when you're dead, you're done. So let the good time roll. Let the good time roll. I don't care if you're young or old. Let's get together and let the good time roll.
Bluesman also goes by the name KC, which stands for Kansas City, as Bluesman was a blues singer in Kansas City for many years before calling Southern Illinois his home. There's little to no existing evidence in the way of pictures or any kind of recording from this time, but anyone who has been around Bluesman can tell that Kansas City is a part of who he is, as he seems to have many fond memories of his time there. KC makes his living doing carpentry work, so sometimes I would have him help me out with things at my trailer. And at one point, after doing some work for me, we made a loose agreement that I would help him make a CD. I found it strange that in all his years singing blues, Bluesman had never made any recordings. Just who was Bluesman, and what was his story? It's questions like this that made me decide to film a documentary about Bluesman. So in November 2013, I set out with meager camera equipment and no real budget to find Bluesman and ask him if I could make a documentary about him. Last we heard, Bluesman was in Menard Prison, as Bluesman was recently put in jail for assaulting a man in front of PK's, a local bar. Bluesman claims it was self-defense, which is what he also claims for the last 3 or 4 assault charges that have been brought against him since he has been living in Southern Illinois. When I arrived at the prison and asked to see Bluesman, a woman at the front desk told me he had actually been released 2 weeks ago to a different facility, but she wasn't allowed to tell me which one. After an unsuccessful internet search, I eventually found out from Archie, the trailer park manager, that Bluesman was in a halfway house in Marion, Illinois called the H Group. He was scheduled to be released at the beginning of February. I talked to Bluesman over the phone, and he agreed to participate in the documentary. Later, he got passes to leave the halfway house, so I began my interviews with him to learn more about his background.
How long have you been singing blues your whole life?
Ooh, well, my adult life, I say. I've been singing the blues. I started singing the blues in Kansas City. Actually, started going on stage probably about 1985. I bet just went on from there.
Yeah,
I worked the clubs in Kansas City for a while.
What made you leave Kansas City to come out here?
Well, my dad. I had been promising him that I was going to come out and help him, you know. So I came out here when I got to where I could get away from Kansas City. I thought about that.
Bluesman tells me that he wants to quit drinking alcohol. And while I want to believe he will, KC has been a steady and consistent alcoholic for many years.
So you've been going to AA?
Oh, yeah. Leave that alcohol stuff alone, man. It ain't no good for you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it can ruin your life. That's for sure.
You serious about this AA thing?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, man. I'm 55 years old. I haven't had my share of liquor. When you lose the one you love, your heart go through changes, especially when the sweet memory still hold a thrill. And just when you think the pain is all gone, don't fool yourself, 'cause here's the deal. That's the way love works. You've got to hurt before you heal. That's the blues, man. That's the blues. That's living the blues right there.
A few weeks later, Bluesman is released from H Group, although he decides to stay at his sister's house in Marion so that he can keep his job at a local fishery.
We just left the halfway
H group
halfway house. How does it feel to be a free man again?
Feels good.
Does it?
Feels real good.
I'm sure it does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can pick up the pieces and drive on, man.
Yeah.
This is one of the first songs I wrote all back in the mid-90s. I was really thinking about my wife at the time when I wrote this one. I hung all of your pictures all through the house. So when I go from room to room, I can see your pretty smile. I rush home from work every evening, expecting for you to call. All these things I do because I miss you, baby. Woman, I swear, you just don't care. Whoa, I swear, you just don't care. The very day that you left, you said wouldn't be gone too long. But it's been 3 weeks now, baby. Girl, I don't think that you're coming home. And it's gotten to the point lately that I can't get you off of my mind. And when I think about you never said goodbye. Woman, I swear, you just don't care. I swear, you just don't care. Now there are so many things I really need to say. Darling, It's so lonely here. Whoa, since you're gone away, you never had to worry about having food to eat. I've always made enough money to buy you all the little things you need. Nice jewelry, fine clothes, a brand new car. I even bought you a house over on a quiet street. All these things I did just to please you, baby. Woman, I swear, you just don't care.
A month later, I meet up with Bluesman and Marion again to film some interviews. He told me over the phone a few nights ago that he has since quit his job at the fishery and has gone back to drinking again. Later in the day, I take Bluesman to Raccoon Valley for a while so that he can see his home again for the first time in 15 months. Casey's yard is filled with old junk and relics from the past that he claims he will either sell or fix someday.
The police was against me. I was saying, wait, hold on, man. I said, talk to this lady right here. That's who I've been standing here talking to. But there was one police out there. Man, they had about 15, 20 police come out of that station. Deputy sheriffs. But I wasn't doing anything wrong. I was trying. I was going to the store for him. He told me to use his bike because somebody had just took mine. I'm out there talking to that lady officer to see if she can go in there and check their film and they can tell me who took that bicycle for their camera shine right on the front of that guy's, right by his front door. It's on the corner of the building. Right, you go in the stores now, you see them ball cameras. They got one right on the corner of the building. That's all I was doing. But he drunk. And he's stupid when he get drunk. I know I've been there before. No. All bullshit set aside. He not acknowledging that I just left his place and I'm using his bike, that he told me to use his bike to go to the store. He not acknowledging that. He's drunk. So he come running out the house. Why you come over to the police station with my bike? Why are you going with my bike? He got these police thinking I done stole his damn bicycle. Well, I'm talking to this lady about my bike is missing, but I went back over there early this morning. Well, this afternoon more so less, before he come got me. And my bike was back at his house. Somebody come through there, somebody he know, come through there. But today, I started loving you again. Well, today, girl, I started loving you again. This is where I used to stand here on the weekend and just look out over this country, this beautiful land out here. I love it out here. And I'd stand here and sing the blues. I would. And I'm right back where I've really always been. I got over you just long enough, girl, to let my poor heart mend. And today, I started loving you all over again. Well, today, girl,
let's pick it up just a little bit. Give me some snap. That's what I'm talking about. You got it, man. See, you even knew where to make the change, and I ain't even say nothing. That's what I'm talking about. I woke up this morning, and I looked around. I thought about my baby. I laid back down, and my eyes were running water. And my head was all in a spin. Yeah. Love of mine, love of mine. Why don't you come on in. Just keep on stroking. Don't quit. Just keep up the tempo. That's what you need. There you go. Yeah. We're in remission right now. We're going to bring it back around. All right, right here. I woke up this morning and I looked around. I thought about my baby. I lay back down and my eyes were running water and my head was all in a spin. Yeah. Love of mine, love of mine, why don't you come a honey? That's what I'm talking about. I need my baby. The hole is squeezing me tight.
Surprisingly, Bluesman called me up one night to tell me that he had a band that he played with locally a few years ago called Strictly Business, and that he had actually gotten them all back together, with the exception of his guitarist, who had backed out on him. Bluesman wanted to know if I would fill the spot. I don't have a lot of experience playing blues, but I have been playing guitar for a long time, and I know I could push things forward for KC and help get him back performing on stage, which is what I really wanted to film anyway. So I agreed and prepared myself to enter the fray. The next night, I get together with the band to practice. We set up in a car detailing shop owned by DeLance, the drummer. We gon' get this together. Apparently, Bluesman has a gig already scheduled for the group the next night at a juke joint in Marion. He also told me that the band was tight and that they would already know the songs that him and I had chose to play. But it's apparent when I get there that KC was just talking them up. No one really knew any of the songs. Later, Chuck, the guitarist that had originally backed out, shows up. Chuck seems like a nice enough guy, but some inconsistencies in his guitar playing and his attitude towards practicing make me worry that he's just not ready to play with the group.
Hey, everybody bring it down. Let's just put out. We all fighting over here.
Yeah, now, let's do it.
Let's go do it.
The band goes on to spend most of the night arguing with each other, and there are equipment shortages as well. Luckily, Bob, a local studio owner, comes by with some for us to use. It does seem, though, that there are some rays of hope for the band. DeLance is a solid drummer, and I consider Bluesman lucky to have him. 40, the bass player, has a combative personality, but he plays his instrument well and has good timing sense. Practice into the wee hours of the morning. And while we do manage to get into a groove at times, it's clear to everyone in the band that we're not ready, except Bluesman. And when we mention this to him, he becomes upset. Bluesman's attitude worries me, as it seems he is more than willing to put on a subpar performance for an audience, all for the sake of being on stage and having people see him sing. I begin to question his quality standards. I go to Marion the following afternoon to try and convince Bluesman that we need to cancel the gig. After some initial resistance, he eventually gives in and admits the band isn't ready to perform yet.
Yeah. No, we gotta go up. When we go up on that stage, we gotta be ready, man. We gotta be not 99%, but 110%. All right.
Man, so what did Delance have to say?
He feel the same way you do. He feel the same way you do, that we not ready. He feel like we did accomplish something last night,
yeah,
but we're not ready. He feel like, you know, for the time that we put in, we didn't accomplish what we should have for this time that we were there. But when we did get a groove, we got a groove. When we did get in the groove, we did get in the groove. So he saw the good in it and he saw the bad out of it. So he's on the same page with you, which I'm on that page now, that we're gonna cancel this show. And we're gonna put some work in. We're gonna put some work in on some rehearsal so we can come out 110%.
Bluesman goes to talk to the manager at the bar we were supposed to play at to cancel the show. While there, a woman tells KC that she will pay him to catch a couple of fish for her. Recent heavy rains have flooded the Marion suburbs, and large buffalo fish are trapped in small streams and puddles. And the woman takes us down the street to where she saw some guys hunting them with bows and arrows.
Okay.
Because I was about to walk down there barefooted. But guess what? Valvino don't like being barefooted. I never like being barefooted. My sucker, if the house catch on fire and I gotta run out, I got my sucker on.
They're just coming back, like, from the flooded
area. Right. And I don't even like being barefoot. Man, let me put your boots on. Let me put them waders on for a minute, man. I know, but let me use them for... Look, man, this concrete hard, motherfucker.
With only a small net to catch the fish, KC tries to get the guys bow hunting to give him some of theirs.
I'm gonna give her a couple of fish.
He's already gone. Most of these are already gone.
Man, y'all gonna catch some more though.
Hopefully.
Okay. Now what I'm saying, y'all gonna catch some more, man.
The blues, I'm the little blues man.
Okay.
Yeah. And we just try to get us a fish.
Here you go. I just seen.
The guys with the bows eventually agree to give a few fish to KC.
Ow. I ain't used to this shit, man. We're gonna put him in this bag right here. Yeah, that's what I need under my feet. So since y'all gonna be out here making y'all money, do the little blues man a small favor.
Out of the kindness of your heart.
Many years of having to hustle his way through life have made KC good at talking people into giving him what he wants. Although the woman who brought us there never did pay him for the fish. Further on down the road, we decide to try for some fish of our own. I go talk to Delance to find out some backstory about Strictly Business. I want to get a better idea of where they have been and where they are now as a group.
we've probably been really all together. We got a good two and a half years of a lot of rehearsing, a lot of working out, getting better as a band and as a team. We did some shows. We've had some shows down the street. We've had some shows at different little venues, Elks Club, things like that, where people would invite us to come in and do events and hold, you know. But I'd say probably 4 years, 4 or 5 years, only really 2 good years of, you know, after that it got sporadic. Everybody start falling off, you know. And like today, that was my first time probably being with the whole group of guys in the last, we hadn't seen each other since about 08, 09, I think, when it all come apart. So now everybody's rusty and trying to put it back together. And today, I think, as we're kind of reforming to help the Bluesman put itself back in the light, I think that's still going to be one of the main problems. The dedication and the work time, what we do with it, how we utilize our work time, and if we're dedicated to being there. I mean, it just depends on how hungry KC truly is. And he's been doing this for a long time. He knows his gift, but he has to understand you got to surround yourself. And I think he's calling on strictly business, because that's just the last group of guys that he was entertaining with. But he knows how it kind of works. Like I said, we need some more pieces. We need some more dedication, you know.
I was sitting at the bar in my favorite cafe, Max Born Grill, where when a stranger, he came walking my way. I'm sitting at the bar. He said, "Do you mind if I sit down with you?" He started talking about his woman, what I was hearing. I was hoping it wasn't true, but he kept on talking. I knew it wouldn't know, maybe his old lady and my old lady. She was the same lady. Oh, yes, she was. Now, he said that she had a sister and that she was fine. What loud as could be. Well, her sister name. I'm checking this shit out. Her sister's name was Christine. He said, "Little Blues Man Junior, I'm the Little Blues Man, was the name of her baby." Well, he said her mother's name, it just happened to be Sadie. You know, I knew right then this was no maybe. His old lady and my old lady, she was the same lady. And that's a shame, y'all. Now, he said her loving, it was the best he ever had. Deep down in my heart, oh, I felt so sad. He said she did things for him that would blow my mind. That's when the tears started falling down my eyes. I got up from the bar. I walked out the door. I got in and drove off in my car. Whoa, I drove around. I cried all night long. I wondered why why my baby would do me wrong. Now I didn't want to hear no lies and alibis. I didn't even bother, I didn't bother to tell her goodbye. Cause what I knew was driving me crazy. His old lady and my old lady, she was the same lady. Oh yes, she was. His old lady and my old lady. His old lady and my old lady, she was the same lady. Wait a minute. I did my best to try to be a good man, but knowing what I know right now, I still love her so. But his old lady and my old lady, she was the same lady.
I talked to KC about his past. We start all the way back at his childhood.
I was actually raised in Louisiana. I was born in Oklahoma. We stayed there till I was about 5 years old, because I remember going to kindergarten in Oklahoma. We eventually, my dad's from between St. Louis and Southern Illinois. I found out later, my grandmother, my dad's mother was in St. Louis, my dad's father was in Carbondale. Most of my dad's people on his father's side are down here, was from over here in Carbondale, among other places. My dad actually came up. I know you asked about me, but the Kendrick name goes back a ways. It goes back to slavery. My great-grandfather was an Englishman. That's what my daddy told me. So evidently, my great-grandfather was a white guy, Mr. Jim Kendrick. But evidently, he must have loved that black woman. Married her and they had a whole bunch of kids. They ventured from a town called Kendrick, Mississippi. In other words, the community where my dad, my grandfather and them came from was named after them, because at one time it was a plantation. And mom took us to her people down, around her people to down in Jonesboro, Louisiana. Mm-hmm. So I did my early educational years down there, first grade to 12th grade.
And what was your relationship with your mother like? What kind of lady was she?
Oh man, she was real. My mama didn't play. My mama didn't beat us, but she tore our behinds up. She raised us like her mother and father raised her. Do the right thing, go to church. They believed in that. You work. My mama took good care of us to be a single mother with 8 children. My mother did a magnificent job. I had 3 sisters and 4 brothers. I'm in the middle.
And your father, he was out of the picture at what point?
He was out of the picture most of my life.
Yeah.
I saw my dad again for the first time. I think I was about 27 years old. It was around about 87.
I also asked Bluesman to tell me more about his Kansas City days. When you were playing a lot in Kansas City, like how big were you well known in Kansas City?
I was very well known. I was well known at all of the small places, which it was a lot of.
Nobody ever offered you a record deal?
No, but Bobby Bland, I met him in Max Bond Grill at one time, and I didn't know who he was. I hadn't seen the man's face on album covers and stuff. I wasn't paying attention. Just seeing him face to face. And I just got through singing, and I had been doing some of his music more likely. But whatever I did, when I got off the stage, he liked it. And he's standing at the bar. When I walked up to the bar, and he asked me if I wanted to go on the road. I told him. I really thought about it. And he didn't work hard to convince me or nothing. He took my first answer. I told him no. But I didn't know who I was talking to. that no might have been the right answer. Because I don't know where I would be right. It might have been the right answer, might have been the wrong answer. I wasn't ready. He probably could have got me ready, you know, by working with me, by him already being up there. He could have got me ready. Young man, I had seen a movie about Billie Holiday, Lady Singing Blues with Diana Ross, the drug scene. I'd seen a couple of movies like that with artists, good artists, that it felt got out there and fell off on drugs. But by me being young, I was honestly scared that that could happen to me. And I felt like if I leave with this guy, I don't even know who he is. You know, he might not manage me right, this or that. And I end up out there on drugs or something and end up coming back home flop. You know, so I didn't go. That was my theory. That was how I felt. So I turned it down. And to this very day, I don't know how wise of a decision that was. In a way, it could be the best decision. I'll never know. Well, so now it's time now for me to do my thing. Think I'm more ready now than I ever been.
The Southern Illinois region is an ever-growing hotbed of musical activity. Carbondale and the surrounding towns offer many different venues for musicians to play at, and the band has a chance of making a decent amount of money, especially on the local wine trail, where blues music is popular among patrons. During the band's downtime, I continue to practice with Bluesman one-on-one. Bluesman has issues with timing when playing with the band, often missing his cues, so I try to work on it with him. I believe KC has been singing by himself for so long that he sometimes ignores the rhythm the band is keeping and only listens to the rhythm he hears in his head. We also do some open mics to get Bluesman used to performing on stage again. Gets together again, although there have been a few changes. We decide to go on without Chuck for now, and without his own bass rig or transportation to practice, 40 would no longer play in the group. In the meantime, we also adopt the new name of the Little Bluesman Band. DeLance invites his cousin Dino to sit in with us. Dino has an aggressive style, and we are impressed with his playing, but he is put off by the idea of playing straight blues, and he turns down our offer for him to join the band. On one Saturday afternoon, Bluesman and I decide to play at an open mic at Honker Hill Winery. A couple of friendly house musicians join us on stage.
Yeah.
Without a bass player, the band is dead in the water as far as playing shows, and I begin to hold band meetings to discuss issues within the band. I feel like I'm doing a lot of work to keep the group functioning, but no one is matching me on my effort. KC and DeLance invite Chuck back for a spell to try and fill in the sound by playing bass lines on his guitar, but it doesn't quite work out. Eager to go on the road to do a show, Bluesman and I head down to Cape Girardeau, Missouri to play an open mic at a local bar. My excitement to leave town, I forgot that Bluesman was still on parole, which makes it illegal for him to leave the state. He reminds me of this before we get into Cape, saying that he didn't want to tell me earlier because he thought I would want to change my mind about going. What'd you do in the military, Bluesman?
I was a vehicle recovery specialist. I drove tow tanks, tow trucks, all of the equipment that we use to tow vehicles. That was my job.
Bluesman was later kicked out of the military for fighting on two separate occasions.
I have the recovery chili.
Just because he gets a kick out of doing those kind of things, I just keep on falling in space like that no man land out there. But I know, oh yes, I know, that's got to be a better world somewhere. Whoa, that's got to be a better world somewhere. Now, maybe in the year, maybe in the year after.
We arrive at Pitter's Alley, the bar that was hosting the open mic. However, it was a weeknight and there was no one in the audience, so we decided to go around town and see if there was any other bars that would let us play. Eventually, the Bel Air Grill let us set up in their beer garden, and we play some songs for a few people before heading back home. In the coming weeks, I begin to notice Bluesman's drinking gradually getting out of control, which has a negative effect on band practices. And I admit, in some ways, I am his enabler, as I am often the one buying the alcohol for us during filming sessions. However, it seems that Casey's downside is out of my control.
And it walked up and kept talking to us. It wasn't about his drinking. That man meant what he said when he said, "Man, I really liked it that. Who are you guys? Do you have a card?" But that shit sits with me.
It does.
I wish we did have a card. He might probably wanted us for a wedding or something.
Guess what? Yeah. I got us a wedding in August. We can be ready for that. But if we don't do nothing but the ones we know, did you understand what I said? The ones we know.
Wedding's a long time, my man. Got to play a long time.
No, we ain't got to. We ain't got to do. What's that song?
I have no idea.
A new bass player is supposed to show up later to try out with us, and we hold a band meeting beforehand to get some things straightened out.
Anything. I'm trying to get some.
I paid attention last weekend when you said, "What if I get this good job and I can't be a band practice?"
This is why it's an urgency to work out hard. While we got a little time and we work it. It ain't a short period of time. If this shit really goes good.
Guys, yeah. Let me make I wanna make
okay, I wanna emphasize something. And I want I don't mean to cut y'all.
Go ahead, Casey.
Little blue man gonna say this. See, y'all don't realize, maybe you do. I think you do realize, but let me say it like this. Y'all know where we at. I need what I'm getting, but I want a little bit more because somebody pushed a button on me and said, go on, get it. So now I'm ready to go on, get it. I need cats like you around me. If you can't be there, tell me somebody else that can be there. And this is the part I think somebody's missing. I learned that I got a special part in this act.
You are.
I've got to be on time. I have to be on time. I have to be on time with my act.
And listen, what you do is you not singing it wrong, but you used to sing it by yourself. You could go around the country by yourself and do what we're trying to help you kick off. You could really sing a cappella blues because you got your own timing in your head and when you're doing it that way. But when you put the instruments behind you, you can't come out your head. So you got to come like you want us to learn the song.
Before the band meeting is over, I tell the guys that I'll have to move on once July comes around, but that I will still honor any prior gigs the band schedules. Bassist Joe Beck shows up later to try out for the band. Joe would become a permanent fixture in the group from here on.
That's what I'm talking about. My kind of music. Yeah. I don't even know why I'm here this evening. I want to tell you that the new blues band is in town. And we're gonna clown around. I got a little story I wanna tell you. Me and my baby, we don't get along. We get busted out of my car. She wanna see it out of my money. She wanna see it out of my money, but that will never do. But she, hey.
Shortly after moving back to Raccoon Valley, Bluesman has Archie help him flip over an old car of his so that Bluesman can take parts off it to sell.
That's all well and good. I'm gonna do it like this. It's easy. Ain't no good nowhere, but I better come. Keep on falling.
During this time, my relationship with Bluesman becomes strained. He often shows up to practice drunk, and we begin to argue with each other constantly. I feel that he isn't taking the band seriously enough, and I begin to wonder if KC is all smoke and no fire. With the band in danger of breaking up, and Bluesman drinking heavily, I sense trouble on the horizon. I pick Bluesman up for our next practice, and he has been drinking again.
About time, man.
You came early anyway.
I came late.
It's came early, late. Bob. I mean, boy, no, don't turn. Liquor store down the street.
Man, we don't have time to go to a liquor store.
Well,
we wasted all our time, man.
You're gonna stop at a liquor store somewhere.
No, I'm not, man. So we fucked around. Now we're going to practice. Rolling? That's right.
It's tonight a drive on?
It is now, man. I was going to stop and get beer.
I'm good.
What do you mean you're good?
You said if this is a drive on, I'm good.
All right, man.
I can go the rest of the night.
I think you're wet, plenty wet already.
Anyway. Yeah, well, you take what the hell you want to.
I was supposed to come back wet. If it wasn't for real bad luck.
Man, we need to move on to a different song.
Let's finish right. That one, boy.
All right, man.
Come on, man. You said perfection.
All right, your show.
All right, let's leave it alone.
That sounded like shit. That song sounded
okay,
like
then,
fucking
shit.
Okay,
then let's do it again till it sound like something.
Love you, but me.
I ask Bluesman to tell me about his troubled history of run-ins with the law.
My problem was I didn't take shit off nobody. But I didn't really start no trouble. I didn't bother people. That's something I didn't do. But I got in some scripts and scrapes. And I hurt a few people. And it cost me some time. Yep. Several times. Yeah. Several times. I can't put my hands on nobody else.
Yeah, I remember when we were trying to find you at wherever you were when we started.
It's always men. It ain't no women. I don't fight women, but it's always men. But knuckleheads ain't got no business bothering me.
But that's now over on your criminal record. It's all just assaults and batteries.
Yeah.
And
yeah, but see, it was self-defense, man. I don't care what the police say. It was self-defense. Each time I got into something, a few times it was because not because I was drinking, but drinking didn't help none. You understand what I'm saying? It ain't because I didn't get into it because I was drinking, but drinking didn't help any. I act faster. For some reason I do, because I say I'm already kind of buzzing a little bit. I may well go and take care of my business. So I do what I do. I'm not bragging, but I was quick to fight, man. I mean, I wasn't going to stand there and listen to him talk to me about nothing. Just get it on. If I think it's going to be a fight, I'm swinging. And that's a bad, it can be bad. I know how to walk away. You'd be surprised how much stuff I've actually walked away from. Not enough evidently because of my record. But you'd be surprised how much stuff I've actually managed to walk away from.
Bluesman tells me a long story about his first run-in with the law when he was 9 years old. He and a friend went on a crime spree, stealing things and causing damage in their neighborhood.
Police got alerted because he was up at the grocery store spending them 50 cent pieces. And they got him first. He told everything, they come get me. And my mama said, no, they come get me and said, you better tell them where he's at. I had to take him back to where the money was at. And he had done took his, he didn't leave his. Anyway.
How old were you when this was
I was in the fourth grade. Oh. My mama told my ass up. She ain't beat me, she told my ass up. She whooped my butt good. Then she was gonna let my oldest brother whoop me. We got in the back room. I said, man, I couldn't take no more, Jerome. I said, man, hit the bed and I act like I'm crying. I ain't lying, but my mama whooped my butt. It was making so bad, it was a show used to come on called It Takes a Thief with a guy, and they called him Al Money, but it's Robert Wagner. He played It Takes a Thief years ago where he used to steal for the government. But he was called, and I used to watch it. This was on a Monday. After I got my butt whooped, I was sitting down watching it. My mama was right behind me. She reached over. Get your ass up. That's why you're in trouble now. So then, towing to me again. She didn't beat me. She tore my butt up, man. She did. They put me on probation for a long time. I got off when I was 15. From the time I was 9 till I was 15.
So you were on probation at that young of an age?
From the time I was 9 till I was 15.
Wow.
Back in the 60s.
Mm-hmm. You ever been in any scrapes with any guys when you've been in prison?
A couple times. I handle myself pretty decent, so I know how to handle that too. A couple of scrapes.
You ever had to stab anybody?
No, man, I ain't never had to go that far. I ain't gonna lie to you, man. The weapons are there, but I've never seen them. I actually thought my cellar was making a shank one time because I had to get on him that night. He was talking slick out on the deck. So I let him ride. Because I'm telling myself, he got to go in his cell tonight when they lock us up. Well, soon they closed that door, I was standing right there on the wall waiting on him. And I put his ass in check. He got to holler for the guard and shit. Come get him out of there. Let him out of there. But the thing of it was, you can't just let people, you gotta stand up. You can carry yourself in the way where ain't nobody gonna fuck with you, but there's you that always somebody that wanna try you. And it's for all the wrong damn reason. So I carry myself in a way that I mostly did myself. I kicked it with certain guys, went out to the weight yard. I had guys I worked out with. I worked out with anybody. But, and I knew people in there, people that I've known for years. But I didn't go there to stay. I didn't go there to visit. I'm trying to do some of the right shit so I can bring my ass on home, man.
Later, I tell Bluesman I want to take him up to the Mississippi River to do some fishing, but I take him to Menard Prison instead. I'm hoping somehow it will scare him straight and stop his downward spiral. Okay, see, how does it feel to be back here? And we're out in front of the meeting.
It don't feel that good. It don't bother me to stand out here in front of the place. That don't bother me at all. I worked around in Tequila for like about a month before I ended up back down here. But I like being on this side of the fence. I guarantee you that. I like being on this side of the fence. It's a whole lot sweeter. And yeah. I ain't got to meet head count tonight. See, they already on lock. They already put up. Now, there's some guys in day room and stuff right now. Guys is out in day room.
So this is where you were the last time? This is the medium security?
This is where I came to. Yeah. But I left from the main when I left.
And how does it feel to be looking over there at it, you know?
Hey, man, I mean, like I said, that don't do nothing to me. It don't do nothing for me. It don't bother me at all.
Yeah.
Because I know I'm on this side of the fence. I ain't in there. Speak for itself.
Yeah.
Not in there. I'm not here, man.
You going to go back, Casey?
Nah, come on, man. That's a dumb question. Nah, man, I wasn't never planning on going back, but shit happens. Maybe I didn't do a good enough job of avoiding the last situation. But no, man, I'm 50. I'll be 56. The good Lord keep me blessed. I'll be 56 August 31st. I don't need to spend the rest of my life in prison. I don't need to spend another day in there. You know, that's wasted time, man. You don't get nothing back from that.
Thank you.
blues player who goes by the name of Misdemeanor Marty comes to try out for the band. Marty is known for being outspoken, and he prides himself on being Carbondale's angriest blues man. He's been playing blues for a long time, almost as long as KC, and I'm hoping that he will become my replacement when I leave. But I have my doubts Marty will want to join after seeing Bluesman drunk.
When you in here,
I need
to do the shit you supposed to do. When you in here, you can't come in and keep on going.
No, no, no.
Hey, don't mention the Misdemeanor Marty smoking weed.
Yeah. Misdemeanor Marty.
Hey.
You know what I like about you today? You know what I like about you today?
What's that?
You knew how to end the song.
Hell yeah. All right,
you did. He brought the songs to a finish.
I didn't mean to react, Bart?
Splash the shit out of him.
Bart, didn't he do that? Hey, Marty. You told the band, hey, let's finish it.
I said, let's just end the motherfucker. Isn't that what I said?
You was good at that.
I think I said just end the motherfucker.
Now, understand now.
Hey, brother.
You understand.
You was good at that and you done it.
Now, check this out, though. Understand that you still had at least three or four songs that you kind of was stumbling in different parts.
I slipped and fell a little bit.
I'm saying, see, that's what I'm saying.
Hey, you come back, you got to be getting better too. The whole while y'all were playing,
you got to be getting better every time you come back.
I saw my mistakes. Whether y'all knew I saw them or not, I saw them.
Marty later called me and told me that there was no way he would play with the band as long as KC was coming to practice drunk. A couple of days later, while sitting at home, Archie calls me up to tell me that KC has been arrested and is locked up in the Jackson County Jail on a charge of aggravated battery, with no clear timeline of when he will be released. The story is that KC carried a sick homeless friend of his to the hospital, where KC got into an argument with a guard who accused him of urinating on the side of the building, and KC pushed him when he got in his way as he was trying to leave the hospital. Stay in contact with Bluesman while he is in jail through letters. I am KC's man on the outside, and I help him pass on messages to people at times.
Just like most of us, most just human beings, he's just got so much going on in his life that we have to cut away some stuff. Some stuff we know ain't good for us, and we continue to do it. He's got some gifts, but then again, he's got some stuff in his closet to where he can't truly use his gifts because he can't put away some of the other stuff for long enough to run the road that he wants to run for a little while. And he could do it, he's just not willing to do the sacrifices that it's going to take, you know. I spoke with him. I told him that, man, your window was kind of small. You got people that are willing to work with you almost for free. People are driving miles for band practice and getting you here, you know what I mean? And you still insist on doing it your way. And I was always taught, if you keep doing what you always done, you keep getting what you always got.
know the doorway is 4 foot. When you running through that doorway and you didn't grew up, you know you got to duck. And he's not ducking anything. Just, it's just kind of sad, you know. And it's, I've known him for a while. Good dude, but when he get on, when he sauced out, you bad things happen. We've had bad practices where fist fights break out. Blues banded. Had to take off on another. It's not always his fault, but you know what I'm saying? You think a little better when you're under control a little better.
I asked Marty about his thoughts on playing with the band the other night. He is skeptical Bluesman will ever be a working musician.
Life is too short to be fucking around with unprofessionals. I've dealt with alcoholic musicians. Tried to control them, you might as well try to fucking control which way the wind blows. You can tell them motherfuckers, okay, one day I don't give a goddamn you drink a gallon of whiskey the day before practice. On the day of practice, just stay sober for one goddamn day. They can't motherfucking do it. Don't matter how talented they are, it's a waste of time. You can't be sucked in by saying, oh, but they're good. Fuck that shit. They gotta go. I mean, I don't mean to be hard on blues, man, but, you know. But I'm cutthroat when it comes to that. I call it the Van Gogh gene. What rides along with whatever is that talent, there's this other little gene that makes them motherfuckers addicts. The genes seem to go together. The more talented they are, the less able they are to keep their shit together. And he falls under that category. Man, he's a great singer. He's the singer I need. I've always needed a singer like that, but, well, not like that, but you know what I mean. With the capabilities without the baggage.
After KC gets locked up, the band falls apart. DeLance joins up with Marty to start a new band. Marty asked me to join, but I turned down the offer and go back to my own projects instead. Joe went on to play with Joey Odom, a popular local blues artist. Four months after Bluesman is locked up, his attorney eventually works out a deal for him in which he just needs to pay $300 in court costs to be released. KC asked me to pass on a message to Kamal, the owner of a local restaurant who KC sometimes works for, to put up the money for him. Kamal later agrees, and within a couple of days, Bluesman is out again.
I talked to them people. I prayed and asked the Lord to give me the right words to say and everything. But I didn't have to do a lot of talking. They offered me certain stuff, probation, 2-year probation. And when I first came back, the lawyer come told me, team come told me, man, they told me 2-year probation and a fine. I told them no. I said, get me a time served and some kind of fine. Conditional discharge, I don't want to be on probation. So he came back with that I had to have court calls, and they're going to give me time served court calls. But if I couldn't do it, they would did reduce it down to the other charge down to 4 months probation and a fine. I told him no. So I just needed to really get Kamal there to get me the $300 so I could get out, and he came through for me. Yeah. He's a good man, and I need to go see him today and thank him.
Before I leave, KC asks me to take him to a liquor store. I don't want to do it, but I feel awkward telling someone twice my age he shouldn't drink. So, Bluesman, you know, you just got out of jail for, you know, the other day. What was it like this time being in there?
But by me knowing I had to go back, I knew I wasn't gonna be gone long. I'd already figured up how many days I had to be gone.
I knew that I was going to tell the parole board when I saw them to violate me so that when I came back and had everything taken care of, I wouldn't be on parole till November. Because if I hadn't let them violate me, no matter what happened with this little charge I had, I would have still been on probation till, I mean parole till November. I didn't want to. I just laid back. At Bernard, it really ain't much to do with receiving. Fall back. That's where I wrote the two songs at.
Bernard.
It's quiet time. You ain't got nothing to do. They was on lockdown because of shortly after I got there, some inmates whooped a couple of officers, so the whole joint was on lockdown. The main prison down there where we went that day, the big one.
You were in the maximum security one, the old prison, huh?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's where receiving is.
Yeah.
You always go there first. But I was only there for like about a month and a few days. Then they sent me to, after I saw the board, they sent me to Shawnee. I was only there for a month and a few days. But Bart, it was like this. I know how to get me a book, hang out in my cell and read. Get me some praying time, man, or read me a novel. I play a little cards. I don't gamble or do nothing like that. So I come out in day room sometime and play cards with a guy or something like that. But most of my time was spent laid back. Don't get into that. You know, don't get involved in all this. I don't get involved in none of that stuff, no way. The few times that I have had to go to prison, I always had the sense not to get into the stuff to get you in trouble. It's bad enough I'm in trouble while I'm there. To be there, I don't want to go there and get in trouble. I know how to carry myself. But that's basically what I was on.
Bluesman, answer honestly this question, have you kind of accepted the fact, or I don't want to say the fact, but have you accepted the lifestyle of kind of being in and out of jail, or just kind
no.
of?
No. Once you accept that, you are what we call institutionalized. I can't let them institutionalize me. While I'm there, my body is physically there, but my mind ain't there. I don't let them have this part. I don't let them have my heart. I don't put my heart into it. I don't put my mind into it. I acknowledge that I'm there. I know what I gotta do to make it out. I got an exit date. I got an out date. That's what a lot of people don't realize, they got an out date. A lot of guys don't have an out day. Some guys ain't never coming home. So they don't have that out day to look forward to. I've always had an out day. So I know I got something to look forward to. So I try to work on some goals and principles and stuff that's gonna help me once I make that out day. I'm doing everything I can in there. I won't let it institutionalize me. But my mind was here with you. My mind was on this documentary. My mind was on my music. My mind was on the band. My mind was on my grandkids, my wife, my daughters, my mother, my brothers and sisters, working. That's what my mind was on. I know they schedule it now. I'll abide by it. But my mind ain't with them. Hey man, you may well say I was in dreamland because I don't let my mind and my heart be locked up. Bad enough my body is locked up.
But jail doesn't scare you, does it?
No. It does in a way. Not scare me, I don't know what your version of scared is.
You're not afraid to be closed in a concrete building with a bunch of guys who are dangerous. That's not a deterrent for you, is it?
It is. It is. Cause I don't want to be that. And I actually pray. I pray to God Almighty to avoid situations. I pray for who they put in that cell with me. Because you got to be able to get along with that guy that's sleeping in that cell with you every night. You don't know how he really is, what's on his mind. I've been fortunate. I've been blessed. Like I say, I pray. I ask God, when I knew I was going to the county jail, I prayed for a good cellmate, to get a good cellmate, because he can put you in there. You can end up in there with anybody. It's bad enough that the rest of everybody else that you're around all day, every day, your immediate cell block, this 100 guys that you are around every day. You got to go to recreation with them. You got to line up and go to child with them. You go to the day room. It's at least 100 guys or more. Everybody's got a different attitude. Some of them is on straight bullshit. Some of them are institutionalized to the point they don't really give a damn about being there. You actually got guys in prison that don't have anywhere else to go. You got guys in prison that'll commit a small crime out here just so they could get 3 hots and a cot in there. That's institutionalized. I don't look forward to that. I don't want it. But yeah, being scared, yeah, because I'm scared to the point I know anything could happen. That's beyond my control. But I have sense enough to know the good Lord has blessed me with the knowledge. I prayed and I asked for this understanding, and he gave it to me. That if I pray and ask him to keep me in his embrace, then I'm going to be all right. Just trust in that. But I still have to apply myself to the extent that don't go toward trouble. Don't get into the gambling, because it's going to cause a problem somewhere along the road. Don't get caught up in other people's business. Let them do their thing. You do your thing. So I do my thing. Write, get me a book, pray, stuff like that. I have my own. I got my own way of carrying myself that I don't need none of them cats in there for.
I asked KC to tell me about his dreams.
I'll tell you a dream I've had regular. It's either some dogs, some wolves out in the woods. I might be out in the woods camped out or something. And a whole bunch of wolves show up, but I end up fighting them. I actually fight these wolves, man. And I actually win, but I actually seen times where they actually get to me, some of them attack me. But I've actually had dreams seem like I end up somewhere I'm walking and end up around in a bad neighborhood around a bunch of thuggish guys, and they start problems. And I'm always running in this dream, running from this. I keep getting away from them, but then I have to stop and fight a minute and run again. And then I might get away from the whole situation. And then I turn a corner and, man, there they are again. These same guys. It's like I'm trying to get out of their neighborhood, but sometime I think I'll make it. I'll eventually wake up.
The year I spent with Bluesman was a time of many ups and downs. At times, when the band was on a roll and sounding good, one could see glimpses of the Kansas City Bluesman coming back to life. And in these moments, I think it is hard for any blues singer to top KC's energy. But I was also disappointed that we never got to play a show with the band. We had wanted to redeem ourselves for our canceled gig by coming back for our first performance and wowing the audience with a strong show. But it seemed like conflict was waiting for Bluesman around every corner, and he just couldn't outrun his own personal demons. After the band broke up, KC would continue to sing at open mics and blues jams, but he still has issues with his timing and remembering his lyrics. Marty had asked Bluesman to join up with him and DeLance, and I encouraged him to do this as well, but it seemed that KC and Marty just didn't get along good enough. I don't know if Bluesman will ever play with his own band again, or make it big on the blues circuit, but maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe he was just meant to be a street singer. The man on the corner willing to sing you a song in exchange for some company and maybe a cigarette or two. But one thing I do know is that KC will always have the blues. On our last day of filming, I take Bluesman down to Bald Knob Cross to film him singing a gospel song that he wrote for his mother. Bluesman believes that God gave him the lyrics for the song.
When my life was in trouble and I didn't know what to do, I cried out to my mother. But this is what she said to me. She said, my child, I can't help you, but I can point which way to go. You just follow that straight and narrow road. She said, my child, if you will get down on your knees, raise your head toward heaven and call to the Lord in prayer. Well, he may not be there when you call him, but he's sure to hear your plea. My Lord, my God, he's the one you need. She said, my child, the Lord can turn your life around. She said that if you let him, he'll place your feet on a solid ground. Well, my Lord, he will help you a long life's highway if you will get down on your knees and pray. Well, he may not be there when you call him, but he's sure to hear your plea. My Lord, my God, he's the one you need. And now, when I look back on my life, I thank the Lord for my mother. She showed me the right path. She said, my child, I can't help you, but I can point which way to go. You just follow that straight and narrow road. She said, my child, the Lord can turn your life around. She said that if you let him, he'll place your feet on a solid ground. Well, my Lord, he will help you a long life's highway if you will get down on your knees and pray. Well, he may not be there when you call him, but he's sure to hear your plea. My Lord, my God, he's the one you'll need. My mama said it well. She said, he's the one you need.